They're just walking in, saying anything. Yeah. Oh, my goodness. Oh, goodness, this is quite scary, really. We've got... I don't remember that party. I'm quite happy that I don't. Canadian Club. There's the rock and roll pout, the DD Smash thing happening. There's the DD Smash with less hair, Mark II. This is me as a dude with a very, very sore foot from falling off stage. I had a walking stick in this shot. The psychedelic days of the dudes there. Today we're going down to Napier to see an old buddy, Ian Morris, wonderful friend, and he was in my first band. He was the guy that twisted my arm to join the band in the first place. And from the moment I met him, he was playing with tape machines and bringing all the NME newspapers in from the UK, which took 6 weeks to get here. He was a mad Beatles fan like me. And we listened to Brian Eno and fiddle around with tape recorders and guitars and things, while everyone else was playing sport. They were the spotty white losers at the back of the athletics squad, you know, insisting on losing just to prove that we were not athletic. Anyway, we're going down to see him in Napier, which means we're taking Highway 27, one of my favourite highways. We go through, more or less through Matamata. You've got the Kaimais on the left as you go down, and the sky sort of opens up. It's a beautiful drive, beautiful drive.
Asian cigarettes, a long talk if you can, be my bearskin baby, we're in for a long night of strong...
Well, here we are. This is the Cabana Hotel. It's somewhat resurrected from the ashes. It's always been one of those places that's been under threat of closure due to neighbours and noise restrictions and stuff, but it's always been a great rock and roll pub. And we did many gigs here. I've done many gigs here with the Dudes and DD Smash. And this whole thing with the hotel, half of it here is a backpackers now. They've done it up like a cake, really, haven't they? It seems to be a plethora of backpackers everywhere, but that's the rock and roll room right there. Hello.
Hello.
Hello, sir. How are you? And of course, my mate Ian runs it now, along with five other guys who just want to keep it going.
Welcome to my nightmare.
I was just looking at all your posters and stuff. You got Lloyd Cole coming.
Yeah, Lloyd Cole's coming.
Oh, that old familiar smell.
The smell of a rock and roll pub. Seductive ambience lighting.
Yeah.
Your classic rock and roll park hands.
Yeah.
In-your-face rock and roll, punters down
yeah.
here.
And it's good, you know, it's got the same old feeling on that stage.
Yeah.
There's just something about that stage in this place that just feels right, you know.
There is, isn't there?
When you're up here, it's just...
Oh, you pretend to be the lead singer, I'll pretend to be the backing vocalist.
It's just... Player. It's just right, you know.
It is, eh?
There's just a... There's a vibe to the place.
There is. I can feel it. It's coming out of the walls. Yeah. It's like
just listen.
Hear that?
Can hear it. Eh?
Sustain.
Vibe.
We used to come and do like days at a time.
I know. We'd be here for 2 weeks. You know,
2 weeks.
Play
four nights a week or something.
Yeah, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
And two sets a night. How many sets a night? Four sets a night, wasn't it?
Yeah. Start.
We do covers.
It'll be 10 o'clock closing,
yeah.
Was it? Or did it? Maybe it was 11 o'clock at the weekends.
But yeah. They didn't have a bell ringing in here, though.
No, no. So it was, it was the old days.
Grand Prix.
Grand Prix are a good local band. Devil's Elbow, a good local band.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hard rock and country. And, of course, Devil's Elbow.
Yeah.
You know, when you're on the road from Gisborne through to Napier.
Yeah.
The last big bend that you think is going to kill you.
Yeah.
Coming down the hill, that's Devil's Elbow. Oh, that's what they call it. That's where
I nearly got killed there myself a couple of times. Yeah.
Hamm and Gamble there.
Hamm and Gamble. He's always good.
Adrian's Hamster, of course.
Back from the dead. What made you decide to get stuck in and with your mates and open it up again?
I knew these fellows, got to know these fellows, all ex-musicians, you know, all in the same boat as me. We'd all played here before. The place was an art gallery. And they wanted to...
The exact opposite of a rock and roll venue.
They wanted to get out of that. And the rumour was that the local strip club was going to take it over and it was going to become...
And new and moral indignity couldn't have that.
More or less, we thought, you know, it's just got to be a better solution than this. So we thought, you know, let's open the Cabana again. Okay.
That's not a good halfway point, really, isn't it? Yeah. Halfway between striptease and an art gallery, really, isn't it? Rock and roll.
So you're old enough to have a retrospective coming out, I believe.
Only just.
Yeah, tell us about that. What's the story?
A polite way of putting it, sort of.
Is it going to be huge?
Well, hopefully, yeah. I've got 40 songs, 2 CDs, you know, and then the first one's got a lot of the hits on it. The very first song's Be Mine, The Dudes, fittingly.
Great.
Ian and I, we met at Sacred Heart College, along with fellow dude Peter Ehrlich. We played heaps of gigs in places like the Cabana and the Glue Pot in Auckland. Remember that time we got thrown out because the security guard was coming up the stairs and...
That's right.
Yeah, I got thrown out. And then Phyllis mistook me for your girly for the night. drag, remember? I mean, I come out of school, I had like 2 years experience out of school or something, then finally joined up with you guys to form the Dudes. And we were, you know, you asked me to join and then...
We begged you to join.
I had no idea that we were going to, have songs on the radio or make records, make real records.
We just wanted to get laid, really.
Well, you just wanted to, you know... Once a few girls turned up at the gigs, then it was hard to say no to that as a kind of career option.
Right.
Maybe.
Well,
I don't know.
You know,
I think we were just.
I can remember it well because, I mean, I know what Stage Fright was about because I remember Angus MacDonald from Sacred Heart College and he just hounded and hounded me until I did it and finally got up and sang Sympathy for the Devil and heard the audience clap.
And that was it for you.
That was it. And then we had to do the same job to you, Ian and I, because you were very, very shy and you played with your back to the audience. But then all of a sudden, I think you heard, I think it was a young lady scream out Dave in the audience. And
you reckon?
And you clicked that buzz box.
Yeah.
But there were no batteries. Their batteries were flat.
Probably, yeah.
I think you were hooked as well.
Yeah, I was, really.
Here we are 32 years later. You're still doing it.
Still doing it, yeah, but yeah, probably in a different way. I think I dealt a blow to the shyness. The first big thing was being able to sing Be Mine Tonight with the Dudes, you know. I mean, I was painfully shy, and to be able to sing that song and kind of have the bluster as one who'd had a string of girlfriends, which I hadn't at all, I didn't know how to talk to girls at all. I wouldn't have a clue. So, you know, I guess you could, a late bloomer in that regard. But I think for many years, for a few years there, I mistook excitement for fear.
The first category for tonight, that of top group for 1979.
And the winner is... Get it out... The Dudes!
All right! Asian City!
My first band was the Dudes, and we were a bunch of guys who were together at school, and we decided to make a go of it and tour New Zealand, and in a rock and roll style, and we did. And the summers were fantastic because we go on tours of beach locations like this one in Napier. This is the sound shell in Napier. One particular summer we were touring, it might have been the early 80s. Anyway, some gang members came in and started hassling somebody in the audience. It was a full house. They had all the canvases up and there were lots of beachgoers here. And the gang members pulled out this guy and beat him to a pulp, and out on the beach somebody got stabbed, and we hadn't even gone on stage. In the shadow of a giant hand, I'm a singer in a band, got you to hold above everyone. Well, you just gotta move, don't you? When you got nothing to prove, to be led into the lamplight glow, the light'll cut you to your bones. Lily white, black in the garden, dance my little ones, ooh yeah. Washing bossa novas in the wind, now a lodging machine. Got the traffic over turnpike, in the city over car light. Rain flares flashing from here to kingdom come. Love has got you on the run. From here to kingdom come. Love has got you on the run. From here to kingdom come. Yeah. You get to see a lot of wonderful things on the road. Little quaint buildings and great houses. The corners of things, you know. And every town's got its own flavour and light, in a way. This is the TV New Zealand archive in Lower Hutt. It's a storehouse of national televisual treasures and embarrassments, including some of my own. There we go. Chief researcher Dolores Hoy has kindly agreed to show us around and to ferret out some gems. God, you must have hours, days, weeks, months, years of stuff represented here.
There's hundreds of thousands of items. We do get asked every so often, like, can you tell us how many hours of footage there are in the library because we want to digitise it?
And you couldn't estimate it.
Well, it's, you know, you have to come up. People want a figure, but you...
Yeah.
It is kind of almost immeasurable.
Oh, I love these machines. There's something so tactile about it all, you know, the fact that it locks and sprockets.
A little bit of sound.
1, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Oh, dear. God, I don't remember the bike. Thanks, Dolores.
It's all right.
I'm glad it's over. Radio with Pictures, 1980. 1903.
1983.
Oh, 83. Okay.
Yeah. Not quite that.
It's a Sweetwater's Rock Festival. I remember that was the year that Elvis Costello was headlining with the attractions. Mm. And there were 70,000 people, and for some reason I decided to... Well, maybe it wasn't that one. I decided to wear clown makeup.
That's right.
Yeah.
I just...
So I haven't seen this, and I have no idea, so it sounds deeply concerning. I look like the Joker. Oh dear.
Was the clown makeup just for the summer tour sort of thing?
I don't know what came over me. I have no idea. There must have been some kind of celebration involved somewhere. I just have no memory of it, of actually performing. Who was that guy?
You keep getting that sense from the audience letting something
out. The fire eaters, yeah. This song really sucks.
Are you having as good a time as we are? This is our one-inch collection.
A one-inch small man's connection through here. So after the Dudes broke up, I formed Dee Dee Smash. And by 1983, we were back at the New Zealand Music Awards. And it was, if my memory serves me well, an eventful and hilarity-packed evening. We'd released Outlook for Thursday that year, and it was a bit of a hit.
First, the most popular artist of the year. In 10 regions around the country, we set up judging panels which voted on the most popular New Zealand artist in their region. And right now, at our 4 main television studios around the country, 10 radio personalities are standing by to give us the regional results. Introducing to our show, representing Northland, good evening, Daryl Ware.
Kia ora, Dick, the Northland most popular artist of the year, Dee Dee Smash.
Hi there, Barry Holland, representing Auckland.
Hi, Dick, and the most popular artist in the Auckland area was Dee Dee Smash.
Waikato, want Dee Dee Smash too.
Dee Dee Smash.
Dee Dee Smash.
Dee Dee Smash.
And Central North Island's most popular artist of the year, Dee Dee Smash.
Dee Dee Smash.
Dee Dee Smash.
Otago's most popular artist for 1983 is Patsy Rigger.
How's your day? I'm bringing you the weather from a satellite jigsaw. Today was fine, tears of times. A weak ridge of pressure from the hinter to the heartland.
The weatherman himself, Dave Dobbin. Dave Dobbin.
Only one person stood between Dee Dee Smash and a clean sweep. Congratulations to you, Patsy. But the winner, Dee Dee Smash.
And the award for the best video of the year goes to director Andrew Shaw for Dee Dee Smash's Outlook for Thursday.
So, the award for the single of the year, a very important award, Dee Dee Smash Outlook for Thursday.
David went to Sacred Heart, I'd just like to mention that in passing.
I can remember being inspired by Tim's performance as...
Album of the year is Deep in the Heart of Texas, Dee Dee Smash.
I've been allowed to present two of them, and they're going to go to the same person, Patsy Rigger, and that's great. Because it's the kind of music I can understand, you know. Some of the other stuff's a little bit too subtle for me.
Sadly, most of the 80s wasn't spent collecting awards.
It was spent on the road.
I think the closest call was on the Tuarangi Road, on the Forest Road out of Taupo, and I was overtaking a car. Towards me was coming a Kenworth truck with a full load of logs. I was doing 110, 120 in a high ace, a Toyota high ace. A van full of people. Lost control of the car, really, and it drove itself way across the other side of the road and in through the forest. We didn't hit any trees, and we were careering through the lumpy forest like this, and then we stopped, and all we could hear was birds. Nobody said a word. And I drove the van back out of the forest and drove down to the Aupuni Dam, pulled up, nobody said a word, hopped out of the driving seat, walked around to the other side, lit a cigarette, sat in there, and nobody said a word till we went to where we go. But we basically died. We were dead, you know, absolutely. Yeah, 18 hours from Adelaide to Sydney on a regular basis. We did one drive up to Burley Heads or something up to the Gold Coast, and we were coming from Sydney. And I remember waking up from being face flat down on on the highway, the Pacific Highway. Robbie and I ran up many, many miles on the road through Australia. When Dee Dee Smash were touring there, Robbie was doing sound for us, but it also involved tour managing, driving the van, anything, you know.
Do the door occasionally.
Yeah, do the door occasionally, you know, it was...
Security.
Yeah. It was a guerrilla operation, but somebody had to do it. And then Robbie, we ran up so many miles just touring around Australia, and then we'd come back and do the same in New Zealand. So when you've got that many miles between you, it doesn't go away. Oh, there was one we did up to the Gold Coast, thinking that we were playing Caesar's Palace on the Gold Coast. We get there and Jimmy Barnes and all this band are sort of putting their gear in and going, what's going on here? The guy says, oh, no, you mean the Caesar's Palace up there.
That one.
It's another 3 miles away in Pauline Hanson country, Ipswich. And we get there and start playing at 1:30 in the morning. There's nobody there at all except for this one drunken couple who were kind of leaning on each other. That's all they could do. Yeah. Was just prop each other up and sort of occasionally have a bit of a grope. And the place was full of mirrors, so all you could see was this one couple sort of teetering on each other and the band's going, you know.
And those days we were taking the door.
Yeah.
How do we do tonight?
Yeah, how do we do tonight? Oh, one, two, that's, what's that, $10? Yeah. Classics.
Whenever you catch up with old friends and colleagues on the road, out come the funny stories, most of which are not fit for broadcast, at least not in their entirety.
Oh, is that what we did?
Yeah.
We did, eh? I think Balto took to wearing his surgical mask around the country.
Captain Leslie Farquhar's bloody...
Yeah. Getting into the money bag and throwing all the cash around the country.
I remember the loop. It must just be something about Invercargill.
He came in a white limo with the sides were see-through.
Staying at the Queen. You had
the Grand.
The Grand. You had the Queen's room.
15 dozen raw oysters.
And stout.
Fresh fluffies and stout. And then went and did the gig. All fired up. That'd be right.
I couldn't do that first gig you had back in New Zealand. That first gig, I saw it on TV.
That was a riot.
That was a riot.
Actually, if there was one tape I wouldn't mind erasing, it might be this one. The Queen Street Riots, 1984. Followed a concert that Dee Dee Smash played in Aotea Square. And like most riots, this one was a complicated little beastie. You could blame it on the usual suspects, booze, boredom, bravado, times were tight, maybe even the Muldoon years. But at the time they tried to blame it on me, which was quite frankly a little scary. All to do with something I'd said, apparently.
Well, you told the police to put away their batons and stop wanking themselves. And that's...
Yes.
That got you in trouble.
Yeah, a little bit of trouble. I have no idea why, but if you look at the Heinemann Dictionary, the word wanker, the third meaning for the word wanker means a foolish person. And if it wasn't for that definition, I wouldn't have got away with calling the police what I called them on that day.
It was a relieved Dobbin who emerged from the Auckland District Court with an acquittal. In evidence, he said he tried to placate the crowd on the night of the riot. Today, Dobbin got a hug from his mum and will spend a few days with friends before going back to Sydney, where he now lives.
Future, you'll be a bit more careful about what you say. Probably, yes.
Oh, goodness gracious. Who is this guy? You know, that's what you think when you look back. You look at some of these photos. But then, I don't know, I'm looking back, but I'm looking forward at the same time, so I'm quite content to go through this process. It's actually quite therapeutic. Nice Ray-Bans, love the jacket. This is my Mickey Rooney shot. I don't know what I was taking at that stage, but the other guys weren't that impressed, as you could see. Woeful. Slice of Heaven was a phrase bandied about at the time. It was the mid-80s. I'd just scored the gig to do the music for the Foot Rot Flats movie, which I took to with relish and a white wine sauce. But it's just a love song. I sang it to, you know, I sang it for my girl, you know, as most of them are. I sang it to my girl. And at the time, Paul Simon's Gracelands was floating around as a big hit. So I was pretty influenced by that. And so it became a hit. And I remember when it was a hit in here, it had been number one for 2 months. And when it went to number one in Australia, I got this call at 5 a.m. The phone goes, it's the, you know, Sony Australia saying, you've got a hit record, it's number one in Australia. And I beat out Michael Jackson that year with Beat It. And, I think we sold about 100,000 records in Australia with that song. So, it's a slice of heaven. Hey, I got a lot of faith in you. I'll stick with you, kid, that's the bottom line.
Slice of Heaven, I think, was the beginning of Dave Dobbin reconnecting with New Zealand and finding a real New Zealandness in his writing and also in his sound. I mean, he teamed up with Herbs for that record, and the fact that he's using those voices, those beautiful Polynesian voices in there, it gives the record just such a New Zealand sound.
This one is from a shoot that we did for A Slice of Heaven. There's a bunch of people playing, you know, playing orchestral instruments, including me. I can't play the cello for the love of me, so I was just pretending. And this here is a jacket that I haven't got anymore. I think I only wore it once or twice. That was around the Loyal time. Out in the battle, flung far and new, where does allegiance lie? Sometimes when all of your hopes and all of your dreams are too much to value in one moment, and all of us anxious, but why hurry, love? History's here and now. Oh, and why are you waiting? You're waiting for what? The history of summer. Call me loyal. Loyal, it went on to become the name of an album in 1988, but after that, where people really, where it really went over the top was with the America's Cup in 2003, Where the Stick Broke and all that. But Loyal was the signature song, and I learned a lot about, you know, the power of, the you know, the market and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And sport and music and the mix thereof.
I guess the purist, Calvinist rock critic in me goes, what a terrible thing to happen to a song. But Loyal, I think what happened with Loyal was it got flogged off to the America's Cup campaign, which is fine, and it became the anthem of that, which is fine, but I think it'll still endure past that. And, you know, it'll just be one of those ones that I think if you're a New Zealander in any part of the world and you hear that song, you'll probably book a ticket home quite quickly.
I think if people hold the song so dearly that I kind of knew inside me that the song would kind of triumph and last whatever happened, even though the stick had just broken. I sort of thought, oh, well, I didn't think that the song would die with it. And that's how it's turned out, because people use Loyal a lot, you know, on occasions, weddings, funerals, all kinds of things.
There's a black-blue front stole the west horizon under ocean song told.
One of the great things about this musical life is you get to travel and to meet some great people like Chris Burke. He's a music writer and friend. He's currently working on finishing a book on the history of early popular New Zealand music. He's holed up in Otaki to finish this mammoth task.
You've done, you're doing, as yourself would speak,
yeah,
an incredible amount of work on the history of New Zealand music right back to 1918. New Zealand popular music, is that, that's what it covers.
Yeah.
Up to about 1964.
Was the end of the Howard Morrison Quartet.
Wow.
Because then all the, they kind of don't fit the rock and roll history.
Yeah.
And after that, all the beat bands, the Beatle influence bands take over.
Yeah. Know?
And that's all been done by John Dix. And
right.
So I'm the 40 years before him or so.
Right, yeah.
And I start with the Niagara, the boat, the Niagara, which for years people thought that brought the influenza.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a big...
Oh, the Spanish flu.
The Spanish flu.
Yeah.
Yeah, big
that wasted
epidemic.
A whole lot of
people, yeah. Well... The evidence is against that now.
Oh, okay.
But what the Niagara did do was bring music. You had
yep.
a very hot band on there, run by a guy called Chips Healy, who had the band later in the Civic Winter Garden
wow.
for years. And they'd go over to the States regularly, back and forth,
yep.
and they'd bring back, they'd go and see the bands on the West Coast,
yep.
and they'd bring back sheet music and full arrangements
and
records. And yeah.
Well,
and so they were very up to the play, you know.
Blood red bloom, Bahutukawa. The black dunes hiss with the grass's breath. And I will gather my driftwood and light.
Now, that really did seem like a watershed, the Twist album.
Yeah.
Coming home and just with Neil on board and you're in a good headspace and
yeah.
you know, and It Dawned on Me is one that I really
yeah,
think
I really
has got
that too,
that's
yeah.
still gonna be picked up by someone, I reckon.
I wrote that one out at Bethel's in
Tehenga,
and that was a real turning point for me too in
yeah.
that way.
Bringing the Pahutukawa in without naturally
embracing it in a kind of naive way, really. I didn't think too much about it.
Without forcing that
yeah.
Kiwi stuff. You know, Tommy Adderley always used to go on about how, why is it that that you can have songs like Route 66 and we haven't got, you know, State Highway 1, and then he did Rock
yeah.
and Roll Ponsonby. You can get...
Yeah, yeah.
It's just a slow process. As
it is.
And It Dawned on Me has got it there
yeah.
naturally, without any forcing.
Yeah, it didn't occur to me that mentioning place names and stuff would, you know, was anything to cringe at. It just seemed right. You know, I did the same with a song called Madeline Avenue, which was very specific.
Madeline Avenue hood, real people giving birth to continue the love, somehow raise a family.
This used to be a street of 173 state houses, but in the late 90s, a developer changed all that.
Yeah, Madeline Avenue loomed large as a bit of a tricky neighbourhood, and there's no memory of it now, not even a memorial apart from the song. I changed the name to Mount Taylor Drive because Madeline Avenue was shortened to Mad Ave. And it was given such bad stick in the paper that people were kind of shamed out of the street, you know. But Glen Innes was a much maligned suburb in a way, a bit like Porirua in Wellington or Aranui in Christchurch. You know, it was one of those neighbourhoods that people talk badly about. I've had many a time in those places as a kid, eating flounder and watching all the uncles and aunties drinking beer. To some people, these places represent poverty or whatever, but I found nothing but a richness of life amongst these places when I grew up. How dare you call this
my street of shame? My world was very small when I was growing up. My primary school was just across the road, a college about a mile away, just behind Mount Taylor.
I'd come up on this hill just to daydream and think about music. There were no Walkmans in those days, so you just had to imagine things.
Beautiful.
Behind me is Sacred Heart College. I spent many years here from 1968 to 1974, on and off. Off, I would take a few weeks off at a time because we were caned a lot. The drama department was very lively, and they'd put on shows every year. And in those shows, the likes of Tim Finn and Neil Finn would perform without any nerves. It seemed to me they performed without any nerves. I was far too shy to be involved in anything like it, but they would totally excite me.
And years later, my old school comrade Neil Finn agreed to produce Twist, my first album after moving back from Australia.
My hands are tied, oh, I could be a victim. When my tongue won't move, you have it tied with your heartstrings. When I needed you most, I couldn't find a language. When I needed you more, I couldn't say a word.
I think songs go through transformations, but writers definitely go through transformations. For me, the biggest, coming of age, if you like, as a writer for me was coming back to New Zealand and getting into the Twist album. Everything before that seemed at the time like a bit of a rehearsal.
I've got the longest hair I've had in years.
What exactly are we going to do?
It doesn't matter to you, I suppose, but...
What?
But the longest hair I've had in years. I've been meaning to get a haircut, but I just haven't got around to it.
Wish I could say that.
Well...
how did we get together, re-Twist? I know that I'd worked with Chad Blake on Lament for the Numb.
Yeah.
With another friend of yours, Mitchell Froome.
That's right.
A producer that you pointed me towards. Uh-huh. And I can't remember how we actually connected to...
I don't really remember either, except I'm sure that you just asked me if I'd help you out, and I was into it and had some time. And there was, I think at the time, Paul Ellis was A&Ring from Sony, and he was keen on the idea too. So it helped to have the people who were paying the bucks.
Yeah.
In touch with the program.
Yeah.
I guess. But yeah, I mean, it's an appealing thought. And, you know, we knew each other well enough then to know that there was some musical, empathy. In the lap of the gods, in the twist of fate, there's a map of the world.
In the
A lot of twists out on the west coast, as you do.
So here we are in Tahenga, place of many songs, otherwise known as Bethel's Beach on Auckland's west coast. Terrific place. We're here on a beautiful day, but every day out here is beautiful. There's something magnetic about this coast. For me, I knew that there'd be songs. Every time I came out here, I knew I'd come back with a result of some sort. So on the drive on the way out, once you got off the motorway and you got into the Waitax, you'd go into this kind of state of writing anyway. I'd turn the music off and music would start up in my head. Various lines would get together and I'd come straight to the beach. And within about half an hour, I'd have to go up to where I was staying, up on the hill, and write it down or get it recorded somehow. So it just seemed to be overflowing with songs, this place. Blind Man's Bend is very much centred in this place, especially the way out here. And I'd go for long walks in all weathers just to kind of gather the stuff together and clear my head of whatever. And Blind Man's Bend came pretty quickly. You know, a tale of four blokes in a car coming down to get a bit messy. And everyone's got this sort of tangle of a life. Everyone's got their problems. But once you get out here, there's somehow it kind of unsnares it all or makes it all make sense or something, or not make sense in a very peaceful way, you know, an uplifting way. Yeah. Jesus, drinking and Jesus. Two things to talk about, drinking and Jesus. Well, Jesus saved me from drinking. Although I had a wonderful time, when you're in a rock and roll band, it's one big party. And the party goes on and you tour and it goes on and on and on. Sooner or later, it's got to stop. But since I have the Lord of all things to wake up to every morning, I have nothing but gratitude, including for all the stuff that's happened over the years. You know, it's a bit of a strain. The usual suspects with alcoholism are, you know, bad behaviour, broken relationships and all that kind of thing. Thankfully, because of the strength of the relationships I've had and because of my faith, nothing was ultimately destroyed.
I think as a lyricist, he's sort of got more interesting over the years. He's, you know, having embraced his faith and things like that, makes him a fairly complicated fellow. He's not just the pub rocker who done good.
Okay, here we are. Now, we're here to visit one of New Zealand's preeminent singer-songwriters. In fact, she probably is the preeminent New Zealand singer-songwriters in the female variety, and it is one Vic Runga. We've set everything up ahead to be able to talk to her, but we're doing one of those hello, we've just seen each other, hello, you know, colourful hellos. We'll see how good her acting is, all right? All right?
Yep, go for it, Dave.
Hey, Woody. Hey, Woody. Good on you.
Hello.
Hi, sweetheart. Hi. How are you?
How are you?
Good. Oh, good to see you. Yeah. Your dog's getting jealous now.
Oh.
This is a big runner.
Hello.
Hello. I thought I'd come in and have a chat to you.
Okay.
About this and that and whatnot.
Yeah.
Yeah? And you're working on a new... Hey, sit. Good boy. Stay. You're working on a new record?
I am. I've been writing with different people around town and... I should write with you.
Yeah. Oh, any time.
Cool.
I'm hip to that.
Yeah.
Every time we work together, we've always had been able to sort of witness the magic with the audiences and you know, come up with our best. So that's a good thought. That's a good thought.
I've got a new guitar. Do you want to see it?
Yeah, sure. It's not this one here, is it?
Yeah, that's my new guitar.
Oh.
It's a 1959 Martin.
59 Martin. Good heavens, a 59.
Yep.
I was... One and a bit, two and a bit, 2 years old then. About the same age as your son.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're a young fella.
Yeah.
That's a beautiful guitar.
Oh.
That's a recent purchase.
Yeah.
Cool. That's great.
So are you going to teach me a song or something?
I'll remind you of one that you sang on when we worked on it at Neil's studio at Roundhead. Before they did all the studio gear on it, you know, we were working on it and you learned a song of mine. She said, you said, what kind of, have you got anything really dark? I said, well, how does a song called And You Will Lose Everything sound?
Oh, yeah. That, yeah.
Yeah.
And you will lose everything and everyone abandoned. Could lose everything and everyone will leave you. Dig that crazy grave while you're raving, the soil forever caving. From one who's drained the cracked glass of despair again and again.
I think you were one of the first people I really toured with in New Zealand. And I remember being, I don't know how old I was, I was probably only 19 or 20 or something.
And you were writing songs side of stage, I remember that.
Yeah.
You were halfway through writing songs.
Yeah, no, it was a really good time and I really learnt a lot being on the road with you because... You know, I was the support act, and you treated me so well. I remember you saying to me on the first day, you know, you're on this tour. My guitar guy will look after your guitars. If you want to borrow a guitar, that's cool. You'll eat with us, you know. And actually, I've never been on a tour like that again.
Really?
Yeah.
That
You know what I mean? It was. People don't normally treat their support acts like that.
So. Oh well, it's a kind of camaraderie thing, you know.
Yeah.
It's like if you're all a team and you're all kind of in the same boat, everyone's still got to go back to the motel at the end of the night or whatever it may be.
You'd be surprised how few people treat each other that way, but I was really lucky to have learnt that. I've got something else to ask you, actually. Did you find God just before the tour we went on? Or had you... Because I remember you saying that you asked... You said to God, I'll believe in you if you make me a really good pianist. What kind of deal is that?
It was a deal, yeah. Can I please be a really good piano player? You know. He didn't really have a problem with that. It's just, I'm still learning. I think I've got to wait a little longer for that.
That's that's what blues guitarists do, but they do that with the devil, don't they?
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
In 2000, I went out on the road with Vic Runga and Tim Finn, and boy, do we have a blast.
Mercy, we're kicking up a choir with a song called Love. Many millions in the band, rainy pennies from above, and anyone able, play the tambourine. Forget your every burden in a stream of pure water.
Have you always played piano, Dan?
I never learnt properly because there were big scary Catholic nuns with rulers and they were deeply scary. Everyone else in the family had piano lessons and learnt theory and everything, and I didn't have piano lessons or learn theory, but I ended up being the one playing the piano. And I've always been fascinated by it. As a very small child, our grandmother had her piano came over to our place, and from that day on, my whole experience of music kind of flipped.
I didn't expect you to understand somehow in the detail I ended up here, howling at the moon.
I think one of the really interesting things about Dave Dolman in context of New Zealand songwriting is he's one of our rare heart-on-sleeve songwriters about love. Most, you know, what is the great New Zealand love song? Dave tends to put two or three of them on each album, and they tend to be fairly self-apparent, whereas a lot of our songwriters tend to bury those things among other emotions, and it's kind of hard to tell which one are the love songs.
One, two.
Getting better over the years, which is kind of strange because I guess a lot of people hold him to his 80s hits in a lot of ways, and those are the ones that people sing at rugby games and funerals and all events in between. But he's also got, I guess as this compilation kind of looks at, he's also got this sort of great big body of work which keeps expanding and gets deeper and wider and taller and musically more interesting in a way.
What are we talking, 2004, 2005? Welcome Home.
Oh, yeah.
I'd describe Welcome Home as one of Dave Dobbin's anthems. It's one of his big songs, and it's one of his intrinsically New Zealand songs. It's a song any New Zealander can hear and somehow hear themselves in it.
You were going, I don't know if I've got any songs, really. They're all just, like, bits and nothing. And I said, well, I bet you have.
Yeah.
Just come in with two tomorrow.
Yeah.
And play them for me. And you came in with two, and I think maybe Welcome Home was one of the first ones you played.
I get a bit misty-eyed every time I sort of think about that song because of, you know, my father died about the time that song came out, and that was one of the CDs I regularly put in the CD player on my drives north to go and see him for that last year or so.
Tonight I am feeling for you under the state of a strange land. You have sacrificed much to be here, therefore the graces I offer my hand. Welcome home, I bid you welcome, I bid you welcome.
I believe the song grew out of some quite specific events. There'd been a rally in Christchurch of neo-Nazis, and around about the same time, there was a refugee from Algeria, Ahmed Zawi, who was being held in custody in Auckland as a suspected terrorist. And I think these things focused Dobbin's mind on the issues of who belongs here and New Zealand's identity, really. But in his typical way, he managed to universalise those themes. So in the end, it's not specifically a song about those things at all. It's a much bigger song than that. It's a song about an ideal New Zealand, in a way. I think he's talking about the New Zealand he would really like to be part of, and the perfect New Zealand that we do have glimpses of sometimes. And everyone's included in that. And I love the image of, in the second verse, of the woman with her hand trembling, haere mai, which is, any New Zealander can recognise that as the pōwhiri, the welcome, the Māori welcome.
There's a woman with her hands trembling, haere mai, as she sings with a mountain's memory,
I think it actually caught a mood of the nation at that time when it came out. It was played at David Longie's funeral, and I imagine it's become a bit of a funeral anthem, as has Loyal, perhaps. And it's not because it's a great sentimental Celine Dion kind of chocolate box kind of song. It just captures an emotion.
There's a cloud of
sniffles amongst the Kiwis at the back here.
I think he keeps searching for stuff, which for a guy of his generation, he could just sort of sit there and rest on his laurels. and make, you know, and rewrite the same song five times or re-record virtually the same album seven times. He seems to still have a sort of a hunger for finding something else in his music or finding another corner he can push himself into.
What he's turned into is a really mature voice. I mean, he's totally found his own voice. In a way, his songs seem to be getting simpler.
I love it when people say, oh, I love your old stuff. Love your old stuff. And you go, well, actually, the new stuff better.
Rock and roll.
When I'm 90, sitting on the piano, you know, just entertaining people, telling them stupid stories about love lost, the pioneering men of the gold mine, falling in love with a whaler. I don't know, slaughter and mayhem in the musket world, the extinction of the mower. Maybe the last Moa feast on the west coast or something. Revisit our colonial past. Imagine what they did in those towns with 92 pubs. You know, for hours and hours just playing over riffs and stuff.